approximately 11 o'clock this evening, John Lennon arrived at the emergency room at the Roosevelt Hospital. He was dead at the time of his arrival. Numerous resuscitative efforts were made after his arrival in the hospital, including transfusions, surgical procedures, other procedures, but in spite of the effort of many physicians and after many procedures, we were unable to restore the life of Mr. Lennon.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Tom Brokaw. This is today, December 9th. I'm here with Jane Pauley, and this entire half hour will be devoted to the murder of John Lennon, ex-Beatle, one of the best-known musicians and most influential people of his time. As you heard Dr. Stephen Lin at Roosevelt Hospital in New York City say, Lennon was shot and killed at about 11 o'clock last night outside his apartment building. News of the Lennon shooting, of course, spread quickly around the world. NBC News correspondent Stephen Frazier tells what happened last night on Manhattan's west side.
Witnesses told police Lennon was shot near the door to his apartment building as he and Yoko Ono returned from a recording studio.
I saw John and Yoko get out of the limousine. They walked into the gate and, oh God, let me
take your time.
And then I heard four or five shots. They were ear shattering. They were ear shattering. I heard Yoko, and I heard a woman screaming. It was Yoko. She was screaming, help me.
Lennon's building is home for many celebrities. Strangers waiting for a glimpse of some resident are not uncommon. The man accused of shooting Lennon dropped his gun afterward and waited for police to arrive. A detective who questioned him at a nearby police station said he is Mark Chapman, a 25-year-old Hawaiian who has been in New York 1 week.
He, Mr. Chapman, has been about the Dakota for the last several days. He was there on Saturday asking about Mr. Lennon. He was there on Sunday asking about Mr. Lennon. And he was there again this afternoon when Mr. Lennon and his wife left for a recording session. He was able to obtain an autograph on an album from Mr. Lennon as he left for the recording studio where he was going. He remained at that location all evening waiting for Mr. Lennon to come back. Sometime shortly before 11 o'clock, John Lennon and his wife arrived back at the Dakota in a limousine. They parked the limousine on the curb right outside the Dakota. There is a driveway into which they might have gone, but on this occasion did not. They got out of the car, out of the limousine, and walked into the archway area of the Dakota. To the right, as you walk in the archway area, is kind of a vestibule, which has a doorway, a glass doorway. This individual, Mr. Chapman, came up behind him and called to him, Mr. Lennon, as he arrived at that doorway. And then in a combat stance, he emptied the Charter Arms 38 caliber gun that he had with him and shot John Lennon.
At the hospital where Lennon was taken, young people prayed.
If he's not dead, John Lennon can't be dead.
Mark Chapman, charged with the murder of John Lennon, will be arraigned later this morning. Stephen Frazier, NBC News, New York.
It is impossible to calculate the exact number of John Lennon admirers around the world, hundreds of millions. His music and his lifestyle transcended generations and language. In New York last night, around midnight, many of John Lennon's fans just went to the Dakota apartments, and they stayed there. Today, correspondent Eric Burns reports live from the murder scene this morning. Eric, good morning.
Tom, good morning. And at the Dakota now, there is not too much happening. Some of the people who are standing here are doing things like taking snapshots of flowers, which were placed in the gate of this apartment building, talking to each other quietly, and there are only about 100 of them now. But earlier this morning, the number was more than 1,000. An altogether different scene.
They sang from memory one Beatles song after another.
Got nothing but love. Ain't there to eat.
And they listened to one Beatles song after another. It was all you heard last night and this morning on New York radio stations. There were people, though, who expressed their grief silently, with a hug, perhaps with a memory of the days when the four of them were together, in ways and for reasons that we couldn't even guess.
We don't love anyone as much as you. When you're not near us, we're blue. Oh, John, we love you.
But most people sang. It has been a long, melodic, and sad night.
It was also a peaceful night. Police tell us there were no arrests, and the crowd here is thinning out all the time. One reason for this may be that a spokesman for Yoko Ono came out not long ago and said to everyone, please go home, but pray for John. Jane, back to you.
Thank you, Eric. John Lennon, from the slums of Liverpool to the top of the world, it was a bit of a magical mystery tour, and it began in the late 50s. Today, correspondent Boyd Mattson is in our Burbank studios this morning, and he'll take a look at the rise of John Lennon. Boyd?
Good morning, Jane. John Lennon and Paul McCartney met at a church social in 1955. That started a musical partnership that would eventually become the Beatles, and eventually would become the most influential musical group of the 60s.
In 1962, playing at a little club called The Cavern, the Beatles begin to gel, become the top band in Liverpool. Their manager, Brian Epstein, predicts, to anyone who will listen, the group will one day be bigger than Elvis. Within a year, they are the number one group in Britain. It takes another year before they catch on in America. Then one Sunday night, millions of new fans are born.
And that night, I booked Ringo Starr, Paul McCartney, George Harrison, and John Lennon for three shows for $10,000.
Most of the music is a team effort from Lennon and McCartney, with Lennon writing the lyrics and McCartney the melody. Their success is phenomenal. I Want to Hold Your Hand becomes the number one song in America. And 2 months later, the Beatles have the top five singles on the charts. Beatlemania has arrived. The group leaves a trail of screaming, fainting fans wherever they go.
Who came up with the name Beatles, and what does it really mean?
John thought of the name Beatles, and he'll tell you about it now. it means Beatles, doesn't it? You know, that's just a name. You know, like shoe.
Means shoe. The shoes. You see, we could have been called the shoes for all you know.
John Lennon was called the guiding light of what the Beatles were about by Alan Livingston, president of Capitol Records at the time. In the beginning, part of what they were about was farce and put on.
Tell me, how did you find America?
Fell left to Greenland.
Last month, 75 teenagers from Pennsylvania petitioned Her Majesty the Queen to have the Beatles knighted. Well, this hasn't happened. But today I'm pleased to say that they have been made members of the most honorable order of the British Empire. Congratulations, John, George.
Thank you.
Ringo, and Paul. Tell me, how did you all react to this?
Well, I went...
Which means in town. Whoopee.
The Beatles did not have everybody laughing. Many parents had a fear of the long hair and the rebellious attitude the group projected. Lennon is credited with orchestrating much of the group's attitude and actions. Soon his rebellion became more serious and threatening to the so-called establishment, especially when he said the Beatles were more popular than Jesus Christ. As the Beatles changed clothing styles, so did the young people of the world. And the Beatles' records were also affecting the way other musicians wrote and played rock and roll.
You say goodbye,
Lennon not only proved he could write songs about love and holding hands, but also about changing governments and women's rights and protesting wars and social injustice.
I think he was one of the best, certainly one of the best for his time, certainly an innovator. Certainly he wrote lyrics which were far and away different from what the common song was of the days. It said something, it had a social significance. He had a feeling about the world and about society and where it was going and what he objected to and his anti-establishment attitude, and the timing was exactly right.
The timing wasn't right in New York last night. Just last month, Lennon released his first album in 5 years. Its most popular song, ironically, was called Starting Over. Just like starting over.
Starting over. I talked to a lot of people in the music business last night, including a couple who worked very close with John Lennon. They all talked about how much they've been looking forward to the new start in his career and how much they're going to miss him, as will a lot of us who just enjoyed listening to his music. Jane?
Well, for millions of us, John Lennon set our lives to music, and there was much more to come. We'll be talking to some people who have talked to John Lennon recently, including a radio reporter who conducted John Lennon's final interview yesterday afternoon. But first, this is Today on NBC.
If you're just joining us, it's 7:15, and last night in Manhattan, John Lennon, age 40, shot and killed. With us now are four people who knew John Lennon in different ways. David Marsh of Rolling Stone, Barbara Grostrark of Newsweek magazine, and Lori Kay of RKO Radio. She was the last person to interview John Lennon yesterday. And in Oslo with us via satellite this morning is Richard Lester, who directed the Beatles in their enormously successful films, Hard Day's Night, and Help. Let's begin with Lori Kay. You saw John Lennon yesterday, and you talked about death in a matter of speaking.
Well, he did bring it up. He mentioned that if he were to be left alone, if Yoko were to die before he wouldn't be able to cope with it. He wouldn't be able to survive. And he said that he hoped to God that he died before Yoko.
He also talked about the fact that he didn't like cult figures after people were gone, I gather.
a little bit he was talking about cult figures, but
But lest we give the impression that he was all talking about death, too, you were saying he was essentially full of life and very optimistic about his future.
Especially with his music and with his son. He said that he hoped he had many years of creativity.
But what did you say? Who was his audience? Who was the audience for Double Fantasy?
The people he grew up with. He said, I hope the young people like it too, people who maybe don't know my music. But this is for people I grew up with, the ones who survived the 60s and 70s and are coming through the 80s.
David, do you think it's possible to calculate the enormous contribution that John Lennon made, not just to the music of the time, but to the lifestyle, to the culture of not just the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s, but probably the 20th century? He was one of the most important figures, don't you think?
I just think he was, I mean, I think it's real possible to calculate it, and you can calculate it in the grief that everyone I know felt last night. I mean, it was just all night. Everybody I knew was up talking to each other on the phone. I mean, coast to coast. I mean, I'm talking to my mother this morning. I mean, talking to my friends in California. The tremendous grief. The guy was such an inspiration to so many people and on so many different levels.
We have Richard Lester standing by in Oslo, Norway this morning. He was the director of the film. What was especially memorable about John Lennon for you, Mr. Lester?
Well, I think that John represented a period in all of our lives, which was, we like to describe it as being at the center of the universe for a few years, where he represented a sense of optimism, certainly in England, that everything was possible, that a class structure was unimportant, that your background was unimportant, that if you had the will and the desire to be something, you could make it by yourself. And he gave, if you like, the personification of that reflected in everything that he did at the time. I think it's turned out to be a false dream that John had, but if there was any one person that I've ever met in my life that gave people that hope and that opportunity, John had it. But if I may just say one thing while I'm here, sitting here listening to you, that it seems appalling to me that all this time nobody has spoken about the problems of people having guns in America and the problems that people can shoot a man on the street, and how many more public figures will be killed before some sensible gun control will be passed.
It turns out in this case that the young man who is suspected of shooting him, I believe, had a permit for the gun, which is what a lot of people believe that there ought to be in this country, some kind of a strict permit control law. And apparently, this young man had a permit and brought the gun with him from Hawaii. At least that's the early indication.
I've read where some people have said that it was a gun was the instrument, but fame killed John Lennon.
I don't think that's fair at all. I don't think that's fair. That's like saying that everyone should go around and be mediocre and that no one should ever accomplish anything because you just die if you do.
But the irony
that's not
that
right.
He, for
something
five
sick
years,
in this society,
was a recluse and then came out.
That's his right. As an artist, that's probably his necessity.
Let's also remember what it is we love so much about Lennon, and that is the bare-boned honesty of the man. The kind of man who could disappear for 5 years and say, I'm declaring a musical moratorium because I want to see that I existed before I was a Beatle.
There was an extraordinary thing about him was that you could never take anything for granted with John Lennon. Almost any subject, whether it was world peace or music or the manner in which he lived his life. Do you agree with that, Barbara?
I do, absolutely. You know, I just remember vividly in talking with him that it was almost like an exorcism for him to do an interview, that you could never predict what he would say, whether it was poetry or polemics. There was this mixture all the time of Lennon. Whatever he believed in, though, he believed to the root.
What happened in 1980 when he turned 40 that allowed him to come out again?
Well, I think it was why he had to withdraw to begin with. As he said, he wanted to withdraw because he wanted to remember that life existed beyond Billboard magazine. And after 5 years of raising a child or baking bread, it became as important to bake bread as it was to make a record for him.
What did he say about that life? He often described himself these days as a house husband.
He wanted to spend the years with his child. Yoko came out and said in the interview that she had no desire to stay home and take care of a child. She would rather be out in the business world. That was something that John said he was much too macho in the early days and with his first son to even think of experiencing. It never occurred to him. And now it did, and he wanted to do it, and it was something he went through.
I'm going to ask you to do something difficult. We have about a minute left for all of this. Just give us briefly your most memorable impressions, if you will, of John Lennon, beginning with you, Mr. Lester, in Oslo this morning.
Particular time when we were shooting in Nassau on Help, and we had been shooting in the remains of a mental home, which was an absolute disgrace. And that evening, we were invited by the governor of Nassau to come to a formal dinner, and everyone was in evening dress. And John took that opportunity to publicly attack the government and its attitude about allowing this kind of decay in and to treat human beings the way they did. And it's a memory I think that I will always remember John doing.
Thank you. Richard Lester and Oslo. Laurie?
At the end of the interview, John Lennon started singing an old rockabilly guitar lick, Johnny Burnett, and he compared it to one of his favorites.
David?
I've met him a couple of times, but the thing that most is going to stick in my mind, I know, is going to be his courage. And the many times, as Mr. Lester said, that he did stick up.
John Lennon sitting in a bathtub in Hong Kong because Yoko had sent him on a trip around the world to learn to be alone. And that's...
Hey, Jude.
Thank you all very much. 7:22. This is Today on NBC. We'll be back in about 6 minutes with the rest of the news of the day. The situation pretty much on hold in Poland and in Iran. As I say, we'll continue with today, but time now for a station break.
Catch parade fever on real people. It's Duda Day in Pasadena Wednesday.
Back with at least three people who knew John Lennon well, Laurie Kaye, David Marsh, and Barbara Grostock. We were just talking about the music. What did he tell you yesterday about the status of the current recording session, which he was involved last night? He came home, as I understand it, for something to eat, and that's when he was shot.
Well, we, of course, talked to him right before he was headed to the studio, and he mentioned that he did have enough tunes for a second album. We assume that he was going to either pull a single from the first or work on those other songs.
Be honest now. What, you're the music
critic David Marsh for Rolling Stone.
Certainly,
what did you think of Double Fantasy?
I liked it.
The latest album.
I liked it. In fact, you know, one of the things I was thinking about last night was I remember hearing it. It was at David Guffin's house, and he played me the thing before it came out, and I remember thinking, gee, this is fresh, this is innocent, this isn't the greatest thing he's ever done, but, you know, he's still got something.
Could you tie that in, Laurie, with what he was talking about for the people his age who survived the 70s, and what were you saying he asked? Did your relationship survive? Did your...
Exactly. When he was explaining that he was directing the music, especially the song Starting Over, but the whole album, which is a dialogue between him and Yoko, he said, this is for all the people that survived. And his example was, did you survive? Did you make it through the 70s? How did your relationship suffer? Did you go through ups and downs, but did you come out? And this dialogue with Yoko was what he meant as something that would stand comparison to all man-woman relationships, not just his.
Richard Lester is standing by in Oslo with us this morning. Was he constantly challenging you as a film director as well? He spent a good deal of his life questioning things that people took for granted.
I don't think he questioned the actual processes of filmmaking. In fact, when John was on his own on the third film that we did together, where he was playing the part of when he was an actor, not playing himself, I think he felt after about the first week's work that being an actor in films was quite silly. Unfortunately, had he wanted to, it's sad because I think had he wanted to be an actor, he would have been a very good one. I think John is more than almost any person that I've ever met in my life, no matter what intellectual capacity, what job they did, had that great gift to cut through the nonsense that we all speak. And John was able, like with a knife-like wit, to be able to destroy all of us who rabbit on and mumble our way through platitudes. It's the one thing that I missed very much, and I will miss from now on.
Inevitably, there will be the talk of the relationships between John Lennon and the other Beatles, especially Paul McCartney. How did you see their relationship, Mr. Lester, when you worked with them?
Well, I always felt that, in fact, the four boys were closer to being part of one person than, in fact, the public's appearance seemed to be, or the public's understanding of that. In fact, when we made the films, we artificially tried to separate their personalities to give each of them a unique personality trait, like George was mean, and John was cynical, and Ringo was the shy one up at the back that nobody spoke to. That wasn't necessarily true. They were closer as being four parts of one person. I think, again, there is a danger that people think, oh, John wrote most of the lyrics and Paul wrote all the good melodies. Again, that was far from true. Sometimes John would write almost an entire song himself and Paul might do a little polishing or vice versa. It was certainly a more complex relationship than was clear to the audience.
Barbara and David, you want to weigh in on that? Barbara, do you have something to say about that?
Well, I just remember John talking about how he's very defensive when he talks about Paul McCartney to this... as of last month. And yet McCartney had visited him several times, and McCartney and Linda had been guests of his and Yoko's in their kitchen. So I think there was a lot more to it than we really understood.
I just thought it was funny that, I mean, here we are all talking about the Beatles again. And I remember in the Playboy interview, John going, oh God, this is boring. And I guess it's not, but in some ways, he was bigger than that to me.
Station break.
On Different Strokes.
Hello, Grandpa.
Is Kimberly gonna have a baby? Wednesday.
Good morning, everyone. It's 7:30, and if you're just joining us on this Tuesday morning, there is an extraordinary piece of news last night in New York. John Lennon, Beatle, was shot and murdered outside of his apartment. We'll be covering that story extensively throughout the full 2 hours of today this morning. We'll be covering other things as well. Let me introduce you to Gene Shalit and Cliff Morrison, who are now with us after we have spent most of the first half hour of covering the John Lennon story, and Jane Pauley, who is here, of course. As I say, we'll be talking about that story and the rest of the news. And during this half hour, I'll be talking with the current Miss Alaska, Sandra Lashbrook. She got in a lot of trouble with the Miss Alaska pageant officials because she put on, count them, 5 pounds. We'll show you some pictures in which you couldn't detect the 5 pounds. At any rate, we'll talk about that. What else, Jane? We've got some things coming along about math.
Well, how to learn some mathematics from those video games. We'll give you a demonstration. There may be hope for your children yet.
We'll go to Critics Corner and teach you how not to make a movie. It's the new movie called Flash Gordon. The man has to have Flash on his T-shirt, otherwise you would not know who he was.
Now let's take a look at the latest news. And as I say, the top story of the day in New York and around the world, for that matter. Former Beatle John Lennon shot and killed in New York last night. We have a live camera at the scene this morning. Lennon was shot at about 11 p.m. New York City time, just outside his home in the Dakota apartment, facing Central Park West. He was rushed to a nearby hospital, but he was pronounced dead on arrival. Police blocked off the street as hundreds of his fans gathered to pay homage to the man responsible for much of the Beatles' success. Some were quietly crying. Others talked about their memories of the Beatles. Still others sang from memory the songs that John Lennon helped make so famous. Police this morning identifying the killer as 25-year-old Mark David Chapman. He's the primary suspect, a freelance photographer from Honolulu, Hawaii. They say that he had been hanging around the Lennon apartment building for some time. He'd even gotten Lennon to autograph an album earlier in the day. Detectives say that Chapman has offered no motive for the killing thus far. The music world is described as being in shock today, of course, and for the reaction to Lennon's death, it's especially strong in Great Britain, where the Beatles began. Here's Steve Mallory now reporting from London.
This morning, radio listeners were the first to hear the news about Lennon.
Hundreds of mourners have gathered outside the home of John Lennon, who was shot dead in the early hours of this morning. Many of the fans are singing, others openly weeping, and some have chained themselves to the railings outside the apartment building.
Radio stations throughout Britain played old Beatle recordings and conversations with Lennon. Just a few days ago, Lennon wished his fans a Merry Christmas during a conversation with a BBC reporter.
You both look very well, and I think I'm right in saying you're both very happy.
We're pretty damn steady, I'd say that. We're in good condition, thank you very much. It's great to talk to you. And it's not kindness. We want to sell the record and we want to talk to the English too, right?
It's nice to have you back. And thank you for wishing everybody a happy Christmas.
It's a pleasure. Happy Christmas.
Happy Christmas.
And a bra brach mullach neck the new.
Paul McCartney, the only member of the former singing group who was in England, has so far declined to comment about Lennon's death. Security men have been positioned around his home in southern England. Steve Mallory, NBC News, London.
And in other news this morning, there is a lull on the events in Iran and in Poland. As for the hostages, the morning brings no new pronouncements from any of the Iranian officials in Tehran. In Poland, the state-controlled media now denying that there is any new unrest in the country. Apparently, that's in reaction to the Soviet Union's warning that counter-revolutionary forces are at work in Poland. And in Monday night football, it was Miami versus New England last night. Miami won in overtime. Here's Jeff Davis with the story.
New England was leading 6-3 late in the third quarter when Miami's Woody Bennett drove to the Patriots 2, but drew a delay of game penalty when he spiked the ball in anger. The Dolphins were forced to settle for Uwe von Schaumann's 23-yard field goal that tied it 6-6. New England took the lead back in the fourth quarter when Matt Kavanaugh threw for Russ Francis. Francis made the catch between two Miami defenders. The play covered 38 yards and it was 13-6 Patriots. The Dolphins came back to tie it with 2:28 left when David Woodley rolled out, threw for Joe Rose, and Nat Moore caught the deflection. It was 13-13. The Patriots went for victory in the final play in regulation, but John Smith's field goal attempt was blocked, forcing overtime. It ended suddenly. Woodley completing 12 of his last 13 passes hit Duriel Harris on this 54-yard strike that ended at the New England 5. And Uwe von Schaumann won it with a 23-yard field goal, 16-13 Miami, leaving New England 2 games behind Buffalo in the AFC East. Jeff Davis, NBC News.
In money matters, the price of gold on the London market this morning is $612.50 an ounce, down $4.75 from the previous fix. And on the New York market, prices declined, a report from economics correspondent Mike Jensen.
On the New York Stock Exchange, it was the second biggest one-day drop in history. The exchange's index of 1,500 stocks lost 2.04 points. The only time there was a larger decline on the big board was last October, when the Federal Reserve announced strict new regulations on credit. The American Stock Exchange also had huge losses. Its index was off 12.9 points. That was the third biggest decline ever on the American Exchange. Volume on both exchanges was fairly heavy, but nothing extraordinary. Analysts said by far the biggest reason for the decline was the continuing rise in interest rates. The prime rate is up to 19%, and it's expected to break the old record of 20%, probably quite soon. That does two things. It pushes us back into a recession, and it makes other investments more attractive than stocks, like bonds that pay high interest rates. It was only a few weeks ago that the Dow Jones average went pushing up through 1,000. Yesterday, it closed at 933.7. And now, some analysts think it may go all the way down to the 800s. Mike Jensen, NBC News, New York.
In a moment, Cliff Morrison has the weather, and then Bryant Gumbel with the man who makes the Eagles soar. But first, a message.
To some people, winning is more than a goal. It's an attitude that drives them to get where they're going first, to meet each day at full speed. A stockbroker with this winning attitude demands fast information and knows the value of acting ahead of the crowd. He's a Bache broker. The winning attitude at Bache.
Good morning.
Put it to work for you.
Fisher Price gives your little firemen a chance to run our Play Family fire station. Outrush the firefighters speeding to the rescue. There they go doing very brave things.
Hooray!
You'll have to jump.
Back to the fire station safe and sound and feeling very proud. The Fire Station by Fisher Price.
When high interest rates keep America from buying the fuel-efficient cars it needs, it's time to do something about it. Starting now, when you buy a new U.S.-built 81 Chrysler, Plymouth, or Dodge passenger car on credit, you can deduct 6% from the sticker price, including options, because we think the interest rates are 6% too high. That number will move up or down depending on a significant change in the prime interest rate. Get $325 to $1,000 direct from Chrysler. We'll help you buy the car you want.
22 minutes before 8 o'clock right now. Cliff Morrison is here with the weather, and still some very nasty weather out in the central part of the country, I'm told, ice storms and so on.
Yeah, just about a repeat of what we had yesterday. You folks in Missouri and also Nebraska, look out. Allow yourself some extra time to drive wherever you're going this morning, because they do have ice on the roads, and they're going to continue to have that. Look at the temperatures for today. A big thrust of cold air, Arctic cold air, coming down from the north. And that will, of course, affect the entire midsection of the nation. And as we told you, they have ice warnings in effect all the way from northeastern and southeastern Nebraska down into Missouri. And that will continue throughout the morning. And later on today, that's going to change to snow. You see, it's a big change from this Arctic cold front. We have thunderstorms ahead of it. And behind it, the rain is changing to freezing rain. And eventually, it'll change to snow. And I'm looking for the last bastion of some record high temperatures to occur down throughout the southeast today. The rest of the nation has some fairly mild weather. What about the weather in your area? We're going to check that right now. In Dallas, a high of 49 today. Miami, a high of 80. Phoenix, a high of 64. And Seattle will have a high today of 40 degrees. Two of the warmest places, Miami, will have a high of 80 today. And New Orleans, a high of 75. And now, we go to Nancy Foreman.
Thank you, Cliff. Sportsman of the Week is brought to you by the Bell System Yellow Pages. Take that first step. Let your fingers do the walking through the Bell System Yellow Pages. Now here's Bryant in Philadelphia.
Thank you, Nancy, and good morning. Our sportsman of the week is Dick Vermeil, head coach of the Philadelphia Eagles. Before Dick arrived on the scene in Philadelphia, the Eagles were the NFL's bad joke. Now, at 11-3, no one in the NFL has a better record. By winning 11 of their first 12, Dick Vermeil was the first NFL coach to clinch a playoff berth for this year. Dick, to what do you attribute the turnaround in Philadelphia, from losers to winners?
Well, I think we have better football players than they had here, and I think we have more stability. I've been allowed to stay for 5 years and incorporate a foundation of a program. I think we have a better leadership now and consistent discipline and therefore more consistent performance from Sunday to Sunday.
Much is made of a coach's working schedule, not just you, but every NFL coach. Can you take us through a routine day for you?
Well, all the coaches in the National Football League work hard. I stay in my office Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday night because it saves me 45 minutes driving time to and back to work. So therefore, you end up getting an hour and a half to 2 hours more sleep. But most of us work real late on Monday and Tuesdays, and then it's a little lighter on Wednesdays, and you're home on Thursday. And I film my TV show on Thursday evening, and I don't know when the other coaches do it. Most of us have a show that for the fans and the local community. But it's a demanding job for the 6 months during the season.
Is it possible to outwork another coach in this league?
Oh, I don't think so. I think you can sometimes spin your wheels. I know I do a lot of that. All the coaches in this league work hard. The big thing is, with me, I came into the league with a lot less experience in terms of being a head coach, and then find yourself in a division competing with the likes of a Tom Landry and these people. And I'd like to believe that I can make up a little time and catch up a little time by investing more of my time in my program and earning my salary with Mr. Toast and representing my players.
Can you calculate what impact winning for this football team has had on this city? For a long time, I think this city had a complex about its Phillies, its 76ers, its Eagles, losing teams. And now, all of a sudden, it's become the city of champions. The Flyers with the best record in the NHL, the 76ers with the best record in the East of basketball, the Phillies a world champion, and now the Eagles. What kind of an effect has it had on the city? Can you even measure it?
Well, I'm not out in the community during the season at all. I don't get to visit with people. But in the offseason, I spend some time speaking around different clubs and organizations and businesses. And I think they appreciate winning because the Philadelphia fan identifies with winning, with the old world championship teams. They identify with their teams more so than, say, Brian, the West Coast teams, because the people here were born and raised in the Philadelphia area, and they didn't move here. They were born and raised here, and they've had their season tickets for a long time and maintain a loyalty, a high degree of loyalty, through losing years. And now they're winning. They talk about how we are doing. Everything is we. How are we doing? It's our team. Are we going to win this week, coach? And this kind of thing. Are we going to be a Super Bowl team? Are we going to be a playoff team? It's always a we statement. And I saw it. There's a closeness between the sports teams and the fans.
Final question. As a team under Dick Vermeil, the Eagles have achieved so much so fast. Would it still be satisfying if you did not win the final game?
Well, our goal is to win the division championship, and anything less would be a real disappointment.
You know what I was talking about. I was talking about the one in New Orleans in January.
Well, I'm talking about the division championship. That's what we have to do first, because that's our immediate goal, and anything we do after that will be gravy. But first, to win the division championship, and we've made it a little tough on ourselves losing the last two, but we've been beaten by good football teams, and we'd like to think that we can rally and win these last two.
Dick, thank you very much for being with us.
Nice to be here, Brian.
Record of the Eagles, 11-3. No one in the NFL can do it any better at this moment with 2 weeks to play. Today's show will continue right after these messages.
For whatever you need, take the first step, the Bell System Yellow Pages.
For the food after my baby walked down the aisle.
For the photographer who told us all to smile.
We took the very first step.
For the chauffeur limousine.
And a honeymoon that's simply a dream.
We took the very first step.
The first step puts you steps ahead, saves time, money, energy. So let your fingers do the walking.
It's the very first step.
I feel good all under. Know why I feel good all under? My Hanes underwear fits all under. Look, reinforced neck, double seams, and a waistband that doesn't dig in. What comfort. And the Hanes price makes my wallet feel good, too. Boy, do I feel good all under.
Hanes makes you feel good
morning.
All under.
Good morning. Hanes.
Now on sale, Hanes fashion underwear.
For gifts sure to please and your shopping ease, visit the Christmas Gift Center of True Value Hardware Stores. You'll find values like this 9-piece Pyrex set for oven-to-table convenience, this Farberware broiler rotisserie roast meat and broil steaks without smoke or spatter, and delight indoor gardeners with durable and attractive Rubbermaid planters in a choice of styles, available at participating True Value Hardware Stores and Home Centers, who wish you a very happy holiday season.
7:45 right now, and if you're just stepping off the old bathroom scale this morning, saying to yourself, got to lose a pound or two, I want you to look with envy at Sandra Lashbrook. She's Miss Alaska. But wait a minute. She was told just recently that she, too, has a weight problem, that she had to lose 6.5 pounds or she would be in danger of losing her title as Miss Alaska. Have I gotten that all correctly?
That's pretty correct, I would say.
You were, what, 6.5 pounds heavier than you are right now?
Mm-hmm.
All right, we're going to show you before and after pictures, which is the best way of demonstrating these kinds of things. This is Sandra Lashbrook now at 134.5 pounds, and you're a pound lighter than that right now.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and there you are at 139.5 pounds, and I don't see any significant difference. I mean, I see a lot of things, but no significant difference there in your figure. And yet, the Miss Alaska pageant official told you had to lose the 6 pounds or at least 5 pounds, or they threatened to take away the title?
Well, actually, it was a matter of whether or not I was to make appearances. I could be a closet queen, so to speak, and not make any appearances until May. Or if I refused to cooperate, might have come down to taking the crown away from me. But really what it was, we don't want you to appear in public unless you're 133 or below, because we don't want the image of Miss Alaska to be fat. So that's basically what happened.
Did you think of yourself as being fat?
No, I don't think of myself as being fat. I think that's unhealthy. I was heavy for a few years in my life, and when I started losing weight, I like to think of myself as being slim. But I also, I think, have a large frame, and so I think I can get away with weighing probably more than most 5'7" women do.
Well, now, who makes this judgment in Alaska about whether you're a pound or two overweight?
Well, the pageant board. And I decided, I won the title of Miss Alaska when I was about 133, which is what I am now. And the pageant board decided that to compete in Atlantic City, I should be 123, which was fine, and I made it. And when I got back, they decided that I should not bring my weight above 133. Well, when I got back, I was eating more than I should. I was a little disappointed in Atlantic City, and it went up to 139.5. And when they saw me, they could tell that I'd weighed a little more than what they wanted me to be, and that's when the ban came on.
So what did they do? Keel haul you, drag you into a room, force you to step onto a scale and measure you against 133 pounds? Or
well, they didn't actually know that I was 139.5. Weight is somewhat of a touchy subject with me, so I didn't consent to being weighed or measured, but when I started gaining weight, they realized that I had started gaining, and they told me, until you're 133 and until you come in and step on a scale, we're not going to have you make any appearances or even be introduced. And
well, now, like a fighter, you've made your weight, so to speak.
That's true.
You're back in the ring as Miss Alaska.
Back in the ring.
Has it all been worth it?
I think it has. The title is very important to me, and the state of Alaska is very important to me, and I want to represent it in the best possible manner. And I don't want Alaska's image to be harmed, and I don't think it really has been. I think that this has been a good experience. It's bonded us together.
Sandra Lashbrook, Miss Alaska, still retains the crown, still coming in at 133 pounds, which according to the pageant officials is just the right weight. Let us tell you that given your personality and your willingness to come step forward with all this, we think you'd be great at any weight, okay?
Well, thank you very much.
Thanks, Sandy. Back in just a few moments. Actually, our Flash Jean Shallot will be here with a review of Flash Gordon. But first, a station break.
Isn't number 96 the show they tried to ban in Australia?
It sure is. Good morning and welcome to the Critics Corner. Flash Gordon leaps from the comic pages onto the screen and falls flat on his face. And flat is the word for the unacting of Sam J. Jones. That J may stand for jock, as this ultra-bleached muscle beacher stiff knees through the role, turning it into Hash Gordon. What keeps you watching this movie are wildly imaginative costumes and the sinister performance by Max von Sydow as Ming, that inimitable villain of sci-fi fantasy. Ming the Merciless is about to destroy the Earth when a mad American scientist traps Flash in the beautiful Dale, and they all rocket into space for a face-to-face with Ming. Ming falls for Dale. Ming's daughter falls for Flash. And the mad scientist falls onto an operating table where his memory is removed. The movie's one imaginative sequence. Then it is ray guns and dwarfs and people with wings and horns and double crosses and wicked henchmen and the good guys ganging up to war on Ming's merciless mercenaries. It is all foolishly written, but there is an audience for this bunk. The women are pretty. Some of the supporting players play it straight, but much of the movie is just low camp. One caged creature in Ming's dungeon cries out, "I demand to see the governor." In keeping with the movie's campiness, Flash Gordon turns out to be the quarterback for the New York Jets. No wonder they had such a rotten season. He is sacked by this role. In fact, the whole movie should be sacked in a plastic bag and disposed of. That's the Critics' Corner for this morning. Now I have a little commercial message. You know, for over 20 years, exclusive patented Sansibelt slacks from Jamar have been one of America's best-selling slacks. Here is why.
Hi, I'm John Brody, and I'm wearing what I think are the most comfortable slacks in the world. Sansibelt by Jamar. Spend some time with me and I'll prove it to you.
I travel a lot and I lead a busy life, so I appreciate the comfort of Sansibelt. They let me move free and easy. I can breathe and relax. Sansibelt gives me a wide selection of exclusive colors, styles, and fabrics, like easy-to-care-for Dacron polyester. Whether it's slacks or suits, Sansibelt satisfies. Remember, only authentic Sansibelt gives you that exclusive patented waistband with triple stretch webbing.
We're living and breathing in Jamar Sansibelt.
Take it from me and just try on a pair of Sansibelt slacks by Jamar. You'll see the difference in quality and feel the difference in comfort. Right, Erin?
Right, Danny.
Look for Jamar Sansibelt at these and 5,000 other fine stores. Jamar Ruby, Michigan City, Indiana.
How are we coming, dear?
Just fine. Darn these hands.
Your minor arthritis pain is acting up. What this pain needs is Bayer aspirin, 100% pure pain reliever, 100% pure aspirin. And remember, for arthritis pain, doctors recommend aspirin 4-to-1 over any other non-prescription medication.
Honey, you look terrific.
For hours of relief, Bayer aspirin, 100% pure pain reliever for arthritis pain.
Electronic video games may be this season's best-selling toys, but they aren't necessarily games to Jose Ortiz and Gwen Woods. They're tools for learning reading and learning arithmetic. Jose and Gwen are part of a tutoring program at the Fortune Society, an organization set up to help rehabilitate former criminals or juvenile delinquents. Students play computer games under the eye of math teacher Antonia Stone. The computer to teach math and reading was your idea. What gave you the inspiration? Why did you think it would work?
Well, teachers are always looking for ways to stimulate curiosity and get students interested in learning. And you couldn't have anything better than a computer for that.
Jose and Gwen have both had experience in classrooms that didn't work for them. They come to you more motivated. Why don't you put them now back into a regular classroom instead of a computer?
They're in the Fortune tutorial program, which is a one-to-one or one-to-two-or-three person educational program, and it seems to work very well. The computers that we use there, we use in conjunction with the educational program, and we tie the materials in with what they're studying.
Can't stop them. I don't know who won that game, whether it was Gwen or Jose. Could we have a demonstration of what they're doing?
Well, they're playing a game called Darts, and the idea of the game is that you can select a skill level. I think they're playing addition. They could have selected subtraction or multiplication or division, and they're playing it at about a 5 level. The game is set up so there's a timer on, and they don't have necessarily enough time to answer the question exactly right. They might be able to, In which case, they'll get a bullseye.
Now, they learned addition in school, and the only right answer was the right answer. You reward, as in horseshoe shoes, being close. Why?
Sure, because in life you have to know about what something is. You have to know if somebody says something costs so much and then you're going to buy something else and you're going to buy something else, you have to be able to tell if you have enough money.
Now they're keeping score, and I think
who's ahead?
Who's winning? Jose is winning. Why is the competition an important factor?
Well, it's a motivating factor. Everybody likes to win.
Let's all move down
games
to this.
Games are fun.
This is the reading game. You call it concentration.
That's right.
What's the game here?
This game can be programmed for any kind of thing. It can be programmed for geography or science or math or reading, spelling. The choices, which did you choose, Jose?
One.
You chose one, so he's chosen multiplication and subtraction, where they have to match multiplication facts with subtraction facts.
Which comes first, reading or math?
It's hard to tell, but on the computer, you get practice doing both. There's an amazing amount of reading that they have to do, and most of the time, they don't even realize how much reading they do on the computer.
You also teach at a private prep school.
I did, yeah.
You did. Would a game system like this work in
it
that
does,
school?
Of course. That's how I got the idea. I saw the games. I had the computers at the school, and I saw the kids playing with the games. In fact, they spent more time on the games than some of their teachers wanted them to. And so it seemed natural to put the work that they had to do, or at least some of the work they had to do, into the games.
I do see Gwen still smiling from time to time.
Did she get a match?
Which tells me that the students continue to find this game interesting.
Oh, sure. Also, the concentration game has two elements to it. Not only do you have to know how the facts match with your multiplication and your subtraction, but you have to be able to remember where you last saw that number. Now, she's got 5 times 6. She really wanted to have something that would make up 56, wasn't it, Gwen? Yeah, 60 minus 4.
Yes. Mastering the rules sounds as hard as learning the skill itself.
Well, people catch on very, very quickly to the rules. Would you like to break this and look at the other the word game that we have on here? You can do it.
Look at our computer genius here as well. You're feeding in a new program, in effect.
Well, Jose is also studying programming. That's another thing that we do at Fortune.
You don't find your computers intimidating?
No.
No, the high tech isn't intimidating.
Actually, you know, people are shy about starting to use a computer. You say to somebody, "Do you want to use the machine?" And they'll say, "Oh no, not me. I don't know how to do it." And then you say, "Come on over, and I'll show you." And 2 minutes later, you can't get them to get off.
What progress have you made with Jose, for instance, in reading ability, using computers? He has gone from what to what?
I couldn't tell you that. You'd have to ask the people who keep the records of his progress in his schoolwork there. I don't keep records of his progress on the machine, but I do know that he is spelling better, that he's writing better, that he's reading faster.
And he knows now how to read. Gwen, Jose, thank you for being with us, and Tony as well. Do stay with us. There's a whole nother hour of Today yet to come. Station break.
The city's Charlene Tilton, Cindy Garvey, and Maude Adams take on the country's Tanya Tucker, Barbie Benton, and Susan Anton. More than 20 stars in the city versus country showdown. Then there are 300 laughs in the Steve Allen Comedy Hour. Here's one.
The ball's in your court, Steve.
Yes, I...
A night of competition and comedy Tuesday.
Good morning, everyone. This is Tuesday. It is the 9th of December, and we are showing you that picture of John Lennon because the former Beatle was shot and killed outside his Manhattan apartment last night at about 11 p.m. Police are holding a suspect, a freelance photographer from Hawaii. Lennon was returning from a recording session with his wife, Yoko Ono, when he was surprised by the gunman. She was not wounded. He was dead on arrival at a hospital. As I say, police are holding a young man from Hawaii for the shooting death of John Lennon. Later in this hour, I'll be talking about Lennon with Murray the K, the disc jockey and rock and roll music figure, sometimes called the Fifth Beatle. He met them during their first American tour. I'm here with Jane Pauley and Gene Shalit, Cliff Morrison sitting in for Willard Scott. We have other things coming up during this half hour as well.
Well, Phil Donahue will be with us in this hour. Follow up on yesterday's spot, Tom, with the Nashville, Tennessee reporter who went underground and infiltrated the Ku Klux Klan. Well, today, Donahue will have a look at the Klan. And then we'll show you something rarely seen. We'll look at Florida's Disney World and the underground chambers there.
Time now for the latest news. However you may have felt about him, John Lennon clearly was one of the most influential cultural figures of his time. And he was shot and killed late last night outside his apartment building on New York City's West Side. As a Beatle and later as a singer and songwriter on his own, Lennon did as much as anyone to put together the popular music of his generation. The man accused of killing Lennon is 25-year-old Mark David Chapman, who had come to New York from Hawaii about a week ago. He had been hanging around the Lennon apartment for some time. There is no known motive for the shooting. Chapman, who had worked as a security guard in Honolulu, had gotten Lennon's autograph several hours before the shooting. Lennon, who was dead on arrival at a hospital in New York, was killed outside the Dakota, a luxury apartment building on Manhattan's West Side where he lived with his wife. Here is Eric Burns now at the Dakota this morning. Good morning, Eric.
Tom, I've spent much of my time in the past hour since we last reported from here eavesdropping on some of the conversations among the people who have been, in many cases, standing in front of the Dakota down there all night. A few of them were talking about, speculating about who this man was who shot John Lennon and why. Many others were talking about where they were, what they were doing when some of their favorite Lennon-McCartney songs were popular. But a puzzling thing to me about the people down there is that most of them were not and are not saying anything at all. And there's really nothing else down there to engage the attention. You can't see. But the only thing that those people down there can see are a few bouquets of flowers which have been laced through the front gate of the Dakota and two or three pictures of John Lennon. And that's all. And if you're a row or two back in that crowd, you can't even see that. So I asked one of the people there why that being the case. He's been standing there most of the night, and he said he thinks a few years from now he'll be very glad that he was. And we'll use that as a comment to sum up what's going on here now in front of the Dakota. Tom.
Thank you, Eric. The surviving Beatles are said to be in deep shock this morning. Paul McCartney at his farmhouse in the south of England, where there's now a heavy security guard. Ringo Starr and George Harrison at undisclosed locations. There is shock and mourning in London, where Lennon had some of his greatest successes. Steve Mallory reports for us now via satellite from London.
Midday newspapers were the first to carry the news of Lennon's death.
John Lennon shot dead by that.
The newspapers sold quickly. Londoners were shocked by the news. Record producer George Martin, often called the Fifth Beatle for making the team internationally famous, said he was stunned beyond belief. Radio stations organized special programs to honor Lennon. They played old hits and old conversations.
As the world knows by now, John Lennon is dead, killed by a gunman who approached him as he was going into a block of flats in New York City. Now thousands of fans are gathering in the streets to pay tribute to the man from Liverpool who settled in New York, a town that he found similar to the London he once knew.
My life for the last 10 years, say, has been, or since I've been quotes, famous, unquote, has been, it's changed a lot, but basically it's a bedroom, a studio, a TV, a night out, back home, you know?
Just a few days ago, Lennon talked with a BBC reporter wishing Britons a season's greetings.
It's a pleasure. Happy Christmas.
Happy Christmas.
Steve Mallory, NBC News, London.
The official Polish news media today flatly denied a Soviet report of new Polish labor unrest. The report from TASS said counter-revolutionaries in the Polish labor movement were trying to have a confrontation with the government. More on Poland now from Robert Hager, who is standing by live at the State Department. What's the latest assessment, Bob?
Tom, Secretary of State Muskie is leaving for Europe tonight. Secretary of Defense Harold Brown is already there. They're going to a previously scheduled meeting of NATO countries to review preparedness. but now certain to be a prime topic of discussion at those meetings, limited contingency plans for what the West should do if the Soviets do decide to intervene in Poland. So far, the U.S. has carefully avoided saying just what should be done, but left unsaid the fact that no one imagines that there should be any consideration of the use of military force. Nor do U.S. analysts believe that the Polish army could resist for long if it should be tempted to use military resistance to the Soviets. Well, will the Soviets intervene? Analysts here today say they just don't know. They say the signs of a buildup are certainly ominous. They want to be sure that the world, and particularly the Poles, understand that. Tom?
With me now is Gerald Amster. He's one of the few Americans to have served a prison sentence in the Soviet Union. He was arrested in Moscow on charges of smuggling heroin. He spent 4.5 years in Soviet jails. Were you guilty of the smuggling charge, Mr. Amster?
Yes, I was, Mr. Brokaw.
Yeah. Why did you attempt to smuggle heroin through Moscow, of all places?
Well, at that time, it was known that Moscow had been a transit point for persons who were smuggling drugs from Southeast Asia. And as people would travel through Moscow and enter customs in a Western country, generally their baggage wouldn't be checked because, as a rule, transit passengers aren't checked anywhere.
But you were checked and found guilty.
Yes.
Tell us about the conditions in Soviet jails.
Well, the first 4 months I had been at Lefortovo, which is the KGB prison in Moscow. The investigation took place there, lasted 2 months, and the trial then took place and lasted 4 days. And we stayed there. There were three of us. One is still under imprisonment there. We stayed there a total of 4 months in this prison and were sent to a strict regime labor colony in Mordovia, which is an autonomous republic in the Russian Federation.
Physical abuse?
There was no physical abuse at all.
What were the conditions like generally?
Well, of course, having come from a Western country, from the United States, they were quite different and quite unexpected. It was very difficult to adjust in the beginning because we had no previous experiences of the type. The food was the main problem because Soviet prisoners receive a very, very bland, you might say a very, very unpleasant diet in terms of taste. The nutritional factors are such that they are supposed to be come up to international standards, and they do in caloric content. However, vitamins are always a deficit in the diet.
Did you have any sympathy among the Soviet inmates who were there?
Yeah, there was a lot of sympathy from Soviet inmates, of course.
Why were they in jail primarily?
Well, they were in prison for a multitude of crimes, from crimes of violence to that of crimes of commercial speculation. And there were some that were dissidents to the Soviet regime.
Were they singled out, the political dissidents, for any special harsh treatment?
No, they have, the dissidents are generally kept in separate camps. But on occasion, in my experiences, I had also been in Russian camps, and I had met some, and their conditions might be somewhat better than that of persons convicted of crimes of violence.
How did this experience change your life, Mr. Anderson?
Oh, entirely. It's given me a completely new outlook on life and has made me really think or delve into the past very very strongly.
Safe to say you're no longer smuggling.
That's for sure.
What are you doing now?
Right now, I've just returned. I returned on December the 3rd. I'm not quite sure. I've had offers to tell my experiences in a literary sense. I don't know what I will be doing, quite honestly. But of course, it'll be something along that line. While I was in the Soviet Union, I learned to speak Russian fluently, and perhaps I could make some use of this in the future, too, as a some sort of an interpreter or translator.
Any interest in going back to Russia?
Not at the present.
Thank you very much, Mr. Amster, for being with us this morning. An extraordinary tale of life in the Soviet prison camp by an American. Here is Cliff Morrison now with the latest weather for us at, what, almost 11 minutes past the hour. Cliff, what's going on out there?
Well, it's a mighty slippery morning, as we had said earlier, especially for Missouri and Nebraska. You folks be careful on your way to work. Add a little extra time because it's mighty slippery out in the roadways. They have freezing rain, freezing drizzle, and ice. And let's go to some of the temperatures, at least we're going to have this afternoon. You can see that it's really not going to melt that much. Down to the midsection, high temperatures in the 30s and breezy conditions throughout the West Coast. And the warmer temperatures will be out there, too, as the southern half of the nation warms up just a little bit. 2 weeks away, and that's winter, but it's already looking like winter right around in here. This morning, the ice, of course, and all the way into Joplin, Missouri, from Nebraska. And along this leading edge of Arctic air, very cold temperatures. There is a big change going on. Yesterday, Allentown, Pennsylvania, good morning to you. You had a high of 76. Today, you're only going to get up to about 42 degrees. So that is a big factor as this cold air continues to go throughout the southeast. Maybe a couple more record high temperatures throughout the state of Florida and throughout maybe Georgia and southern South Carolina. What about the weather in your area? We're going to check that right now. In Albuquerque, a high of 45. Detroit, a high of 35 today. Houston, a high of 59. And Salt Lake City, a high of 35 degrees. And that's that. Let's go to Jane.
Phil Donahue will be with us in a moment, but first, this is Today on NBC. Well, there's been a resurgence of violent incidents involving the Ku Klux Klan in recent months, and that's the subject of a two-part report by Phil Donahue in Chicago.
Good morning, Jane. Bill Wilkinson is the Imperial Wizard of the Imperial of the Invisible Empire of the Knights of the Ku Klux Klan. You're training young people to be into Klan membership, isn't that right?
Well, our Klan Youth Corps is primarily just to give the kids an opportunity to play in a segregated atmosphere.
It's also suggested that it gives them an opportunity to learn about racism and to hate black people.
Well, they learn that, in our view, it is a good thing to segregate, that the Bible teaches segregation, in our view, but not that to hate anyone, though.
But you do encourage them not to socially mix or in any way have any kind of dealing with people of color.
Absolutely.
Yeah, why absolutely?
Well, again, it's because of our religious beliefs. We feel that it is a sin, in fact, to interracially marry or mix.
There's a number of Klan groups. You're the Invisible Empire, so-called. The B'nai B'rith suggests that you are probably the most violent of all the Klan groups.
Well, we are not, we do not go on offensive violence, although we are being attacked constantly by the communists in this country, and I mean self-avowed communists.
Really?
So anytime I'm being attacked by communists, I feel I have something going right.
Are you training other people in the use of military weapons?
We have our special forces.
You do?
Klan special forces that are trained simply as security for Klansmen and our leaders and our public functions.
Are young people involved in these special forces trainings?
No.
No. How old do you have to be to get in, to become eligible for a special forces training?
At least 18. You must be a Klansman already.
Do you think there's a race war coming?
Yes, we certainly do. We think that based on the events in the past, in the recent past, such as in Miami and Chattanooga, Orlando, Tampa, where the Negroes, when they're unhappy with the situation, they turn to the streets and riot and burn and loot and murder. But the most disturbing thing is that the government is not denouncing this. There's no outcry from the public. All the public is saying, what have the white people done to cause these poor Negroes to riot and burn and murder?
Aren't you anxious? Isn't it possible that you're declaring the impending race war and training people in military operations is in itself going to create the very war that I assume you want to avoid for your kids as well as other people's children?
That would be like accusing the United States of wanting to go to war because we keep a standing army. Let's take, for example, in Miami, if those 15 white people that were killed by the Negroes, if they had had a gun on their person or in their automobile, they might well be alive today. So we believe strongly that we must protect ourselves, and we must be ready to protect ourselves. Even the police in Miami said, you better arm yourself because the system is not protecting you.
Also with us is Julian Bond, State Senator, Georgia. Mr. Bond is also President Emeritus of the Southern Poverty Law Center based in Montgomery, Alabama, and in behalf of this organization has brought suit against the Ku Klux Klan. I guess my first question is, how do you feel appearing jointly with a man who belongs to an organization which is
dedicated to my destruction? It's difficult, but the danger of letting him appear by himself unchallenged, although he's very clever at refuting almost any allegation made against him, I think he needs to be challenged. Wherever he appears in the country, the decent people, the God-fearing Christian people need to stand up and say no to this kind of activity, to this terrorist group, need to come out in large numbers wherever they appear and resist them in a nonviolent fashion, do everything they can to make sure that this kind of hatred doesn't spread and grow in the United States.
Mr. Wilkinson gets a lot of media attention, including the attention he's receiving right here. How do you feel about that?
I think it's fine. It's like uncovering a rock and seeing the slugs underneath. Unless you look at them, you cannot know them and what they do. The danger is that he often appears unchallenged. He often appears in a forum where no one can ask him a question, and he often appears in a forum where he's able to refute the questions put to him by saying, well, someone else did it, or if my people did it, I put them out, or that happened in the past, or it happened day before yesterday, I have nothing to do with it. So I think it's important to challenge him, to put the questions to him.
Mr. Wilkinson spends a lot of time saying that he is not provoking any violence, that he's against violence, and that all he wants to do is keep the races separate. How do you respond to that?
Well, the record of his organization and the Klans generally in the United States just contradict that. It's a terrorist organization, goes back 115 years, responsible for the murders, the assassinations of thousands, literally thousands of people, vicious, vicious crimes.
Let's make sure we understand where you are, Mr. Bond. I'll give you a chance here. Senator Bond, if people want to be separate, I assume you figure that's their...
That's their own business. But the government has no right to enforce that separatism. And what Mr. Wilkins wants is a system in which there's one set of institutions and facilities for black people, another set for white people, and a third set for that group of Americans who believe that we ought to mix together in schools and on the job and generally in society.
You agree. That is what you want, isn't it?
Right, but that's not enforcing our views on anyone. That's giving everyone their equal choice, their choice. Right now, we have no choice to go to a white school. We have no choice to go to a segregated school.
You have that choice, Mr. Wilkinson. You can set up your own school, as you've done with these camps. You can have little white kids and teach them how to hate
blacks. The government is working very... We don't teach... And let me make one thing very clear. We don't teach our people to hate anyone, and you cannot find one reference in any Klan literature...
Don't your members have to take an oath to defend the purity of the white race?
Racial purity, yes. There is nothing hateful about that. We don't teach our people to hate anyone, our children, our members. There's not one reference in any written Klan literature or any spoken speech that I've made or people that I have, my people have made, that indicate that we're teaching hate, because we're not. You're hung up on the fact that what is happening in America is we are getting millions of people that are coming to our point of view because we have a rational and a sane policy.
Isn't it possible, Senator Bond, that the Klan could enjoy increased membership just on the coattail of, for example, among other things, the anti-busing fervor that
Oh, surely. They're very adept at seizing on emotional issues like this, the anti-busing momentum in the country, the repugnance some Americans feel for affirmative action and quota systems. They seize upon these issues and make a great deal of capital out of it, and I dare say a great deal of money out of it as well.
We're almost out of time for this segment, but is it your view the Klan is growing in America?
It's estimated about 10,000 members. Mr. Wilkinson has about 2,500. He won't say, of course, but it has grown about 25% over the last year.
We are in Chicago with Bill Wilkinson, the Imperial Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan, and also Julian Bonds, Georgia State Senator. We'll continue this discussion tomorrow on this segment of Today. For now, Phil Donahue in Chicago. Now back to the Today Show in New York.
At this time on the Today program tomorrow. Back in a moment. This is Today on NBC.
We'll be back in about 6 minutes with the latest news. And the big news of the morning, of course, is that Beatle John Lennon was shot and killed outside his apartment last night. It is a piece of news that is reverberating around the world because John Lennon was a principal figure in the cultural life of this world for almost 20 years now and a member of that generation. Well, growing up with the music of John Lennon ringing in her ears.
This is where it started. This is a photograph that was taken by Avedon some time ago. And I think it's interesting the way the Beatles, the four of them, with Lennon specifically, look like a landscape. And they were part of the landscape.
That was a few years after their initial. I mean, that's when by then their hair, that's probably about 1970, I would guess. Just a guess.
That's early, or that late, you think?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll be back, as I say. Time now for a station break.
Cheer on more than 20 stars on the City vs. Country Showdown Tuesday.
We're back, and Jane Pauley has her record, actually the combined record collection of the Beatles, of Jane and Gary. This morning you were saying the Sergeant Pepper
album
was your favorite.
Some say, I mean, this seems to be the rock and roll wisdom, that Sergeant Pepper was the finest rock and roll album ever made. Others might put the Beach Boys' Pet Sounds in there somewhere, but there isn't too much. No, Sergeant Pepper is definitely the best.
Let's read some of the singles off of here.
And Abbey Road, too.
All right.
I mean, what were the
some of
the
titles? What I think is interesting is one of the
Abbey Road was the favorite.
Yeah. The biggest, look how inarticulate I am. I, like millions, am simply stunned. Just grieving, really, over the loss of someone. I never had any personal affection for John Lennon. I mean, I did not set him on any particular pedestal, but his music is definitely on a pedestal, and was, as I said before, my life was set to music, and if so, it was Beatles music. Every major event of my life is attached to something, some song.
He was, when you were saying that you didn't set him on a personal pedestal, he did not set out to be an easy man to love.
No.
He constantly challenged people. He was on the cutting edge of lots of movements in the country. Lots of people thought that he was, some people thought that in issues of war and peace, for example, that he was too supercilious, for example, that the bed in Toronto, where he and Yoko stayed in bed during, was that their honeymoon? I can't remember or not, and wrote, "Give Peace a Chance."
Well, he apparently says now that the radicalism was all a fraud. Yeah. Which may be, but I don't think the optimism and the idealism and the naivety, so naive, but artistically, so I don't think that was a fraud.
Well, he obviously felt strongly, and he was. I think people say to me, you know, in your lifetime, who have been the important figures that you remember that you would like to have some chance to sit down and talk with, and I talk about as I might, the conventional political figures of Mao and de Gaulle in his time, Churchill, and I always throw in the Beatles. I say, you talk about cutting across so many aspects of our life and what an enormous influence they had on behavior, on dress, on cultural style, on articulation of not just one generation, but many generations. I mean, how old were you in 65 when they kind of burst into the scene?
14.
Yeah.
15.
And then you take him through the generations, and Cliff was saying he's 28 years old, and John Lennon was my age. There are 1,000 generations between 40 and 28, frankly, and 1,000 things that happen, and they were at the nexus of every one of those things.
They were always on the crest of whatever was happening. First, it was just basic rock and roll. And their hair was long, and then the Indian period, and then the psychedelics, and then the peace movement.
John Lennon was on the cutting edge of all of those things, and remain, when we were talking about him earlier this morning, here we are talking about him again, talking about the Beatles again, and David Marsh from Rolling Stone was lamenting that a little bit, saying that John Lennon kept trying to separate himself from it. That would be impossible to do. I mean, he could not separate himself from that any more than Churchill could separate himself from
I heard the new II. The new cut from Double Fantasy, yeah, just starting over, yeah, came on the radio last weekend, and I missed the first few bars of it, yeah, and didn't catch that it was just starting over, and I thought, and I commented that here we are listening to an old Beatles song. The Beatles is all over, Little Elvis Presley, and the Beatles all over that, just starting over, cut in 1980 for the latest John L.
Perhaps
Lennon
the saddest album is Yoko Ono today.
Yes.
Yeah. Time for a station break.
On Different Strokes.
Hello, Grandpa.
Is Kimberly going to have a baby Wednesday?
Good morning, all. 8:30 on this Tuesday morning, and if you are just joining us this morning, we bring you the tragic news that John Lennon was shot to death outside of his apartment in New York City last night. And during this half hour of today, I'll be talking with Murray the K, the American disc jockey who brought the Beatles to much of America. He was often described in this country as the fifth Beatle. He'll be talking about the remarkable life and contributions of John Lennon over a period lasting almost 20 years. That's coming up during this half hour today, and then we'll close out the half hour with a kind of special memory of the contributions of John Lennon and that remarkable group, the Beatles.
If I could just say that a portion of John's life at that point will be set to the song Imagine, and it's very, very moving.
In this half hour, we're going to have a really nice actress. Her name is Swoosie Kurtz. You may not have seen her yet. Maybe you have seen her yet. If you've seen her, you haven't forgotten her. If you do see her, you will remember her.
I know one household in Toluca Lake, California will be watching very carefully this morning. Time now to take a look at the latest news. As I say, John Lennon, lead singer in the most popular rock and roll band of all time, is dead at the age of 40. Lennon was shot to death outside his home on Manhattan's West Side at 11 o'clock last night. As news of the murder spread, hundreds of mourners gathered at the scene, and they sang Beatles songs, lit candles, and remembered. In custody and charged with Lennon's murder is 25-year-old Mark David Chapman, identified as a freelance photographer from Honolulu, Hawaii. Police say that Chapman came to New York City a week ago, and he has been seen several times hanging around the Lennon residence. They say apparently he had a permit for the gun he used and that he made no attempt to escape, that he offered no motive. One of the men closely associated with the Beatles over the years is George Martin, their record producer. This morning in London, he talked about John Lennon and his contribution to the Beatles.
He was very much one of the fundamental parts of it. He and Paul, of course, wrote most of the music. And the Beatles were a unique quartet because they each contributed a great deal to each other, and the four of them became larger than the individual parts. They were a tremendous team, and John was very much part of that team and a very creative member of that team. His astringency lent a great deal to the sweetness of Paul, and it was an incredible combination.
What sort of musician was he?
Well, by the standards of great musicians, he wasn't a great musician, but he was a great man. I mean, he was one of the originals of this century, no question about it.
In other news, Secretary of Defense Harold Brown will meet with other NATO defense ministers today in Brussels. NATO sources say they'll be discussing limited contingency plans in response to the political crisis in Poland. Meanwhile, the Polish media has joined the independent labor movement in denying charges from Moscow of new unrest in Poland. A Norwegian who has been working north of Hanoi in Vietnam says there may still be American prisoners in the hands of the Vietnamese. Here's Neil Davis reporting from Bangkok.
Stein Gooding is a Norwegian surveyor who has just come out of Vietnam after more than 2 years working on a Swedish-financed aid project, a paper mill construction site at a place called Bai Bang, north of Hanoi. Some of Gooding's Swedish colleagues claim to have had an experience which could reopen the question of the fate of Americans missing in Indochina.
Then they saw that there was some construction work, road construction work, and ditching were going on there. And they saw that the workers were Westerners. Before they disappeared, these Westerners shouting out in English with American accent, "Tell the world about us."
Did the Swedish workers have any doubts that they were Americans?
The Swedish people had no doubt about that.
When did this happen? This year?
This year. I'm not quite sure. I think it was in August, but I can't tell for sure.
Had it ever happened before?
Yes, several times.
There are about 2,500 Americans missing in Indochina. Most of them are believed to be dead. But this alleged sighting, the latest of a number of similar reports, is keeping alive the issue of Americans who may still be prisoners in Indochina. Neil Davis, NBC News, Bangkok.
Cliff Morrison will have the weather report. There are a number of people very close to the Beatles who might at one time or another, for one reason, be called the fifth Beatle. One of them, justifiably, is Murray the K. And he's with Boyd Matson in a moment, but first a message.
Okay, America, show us your winter off!
Winter off? Winter off?
Winter off? Eek!
Yes, winter-alls. Cozy pantyhose and panties, all in one, to keep you feeling warm when you're outside and looking smooth when you're in.
Winter-alls are only visible at department and other warm stores.
Let's try this again. Okay, America, show us your...
Winter-alls!
My winter-alls!
My
For whatever you need, take the first step, the Bell System Yellow Pages.
For supplies to build this nursery, for all the furniture you see, I took the very first step.
For this wallpaper so nice and sweet, and wool to knit booties for her feet,
we took the very first step.
The first step puts you steps ahead, saves time, money, energy. So let your fingers do the walking.
It's the very first step, the first step.
Take your lashes as far as they can go with Maxi Lash 24-Hour Mascara.
Take it.
Not just long lashes. Not just long lashes that last.
Ooh, take
but
it.
Long, smudge-proof lashes that last 24 hours long.
Come on and take it.
Take your lashes to the Maxi.
Take it to the Maxi.
Maxi Lash 24-Hour Mascara. The high-performance mascara only from Max Factor.
Here's Cliff Morrison sitting in for Willard Scott right now, and he knows when to be away. You've got all kinds of bad weather news.
Got just about everything for everybody out there. But first, let's go to the skies and take a look at a bird's eye view from our weather satellite. You can see that there's still a parade of storm systems going across the country. The main one, of course, being the one affecting Missouri and Nebraska this morning. Ice and that rainy and ice will change to snow later on this afternoon. Just ahead of it, some thunderstorms. So this is really one of the worst areas in the country. So if you live in this area, please allow yourself a little extra time to go wherever you're going today. Some snow flurries to the north. Very warm weather down throughout the southeast and throughout the west coast. Things are looking mild, a little smoky out in the Wasatch Mountain Range in Utah there, but nothing to worry about. Otherwise, a very gorgeous day. What about the weather in your area? Let's check that right now. In Billings, a high of 28. Buffalo, New York, a high of 41 degrees. San Diego, a high of 67. And Washington will have a high of 60. So there you have it. Drive with care if you're there. Okay? Back to Tom.
John Lennon, age 40, one of the most important figures of his time, dead at the hands of a murderer in New York City last night. With Boyd Matson now in our Burbank studios this morning is a man often called in this country the fifth Beatle. A disc jockey, Murray the K, who met them when I think that they had their first news conference in this country by being right up front. And they're there with Boyd Matson as Murray the K. Gentlemen, good morning.
Good morning, Tom. Murray the K was one of the big names in radio in America when the Beatles came over here, and they had heard of him before you'd actually ever heard of the Beatles. And they wanted to meet you, and they kind of just drug you with them and kidnapped them.
Well, something like that. A lot of people said I worked my way in. I don't think you ever decide you're going to be with the Beatles. I didn't even want to be there because I was on vacation. And I didn't think that, you know, they would know me. The acts that played my shows in New York's Brooklyn Fox, I guess, had traveled, brought along a lot of the albums from the show, and guess that's how they knew me.
They knew you, and they said, take us around America and show us what it's about. And this was their first tour of the United States. What was your impression? Because almost immediately, they were getting more recognition than any of these big stars that you'd worked with in the past.
Well, the first thing about them that I loved was the fact that the first time I ever saw stars really react to the press the way they did. I mean, I fell in love with the fact that rock and roll was not too popular with the establishment press at that time. And anyone who took on the press in the manner in which they did, I was all for. So I saw a completely different attitude. I didn't think that "She Loves You, I Want to Hold Your Hand" was sort of any kind of great musical contribution, even though it might have had a nice sound. I did, however, feel that the thing that I wanted to bring out with them in my travels was their attitude. I think it was a completely different attitude, so commensurate with following the assassination of JFK just 3.5 months earlier.
How much of that was directed by John Lennon? We've got some footage of him in this first arrival, and as you can see, the people went crazy from the moment they appeared in the United States. Did John Lennon direct and shape a lot of their attitude and kind of program the publicity for the Beatles?
No, I don't think so. Everything that they did with Brian Epstein was a joint effort. They would discuss everything, and everyone had their own input. John and Paul had a lot to say, and I think that the Beatles contributed a great deal, much more than people realize, to the entire world in changing our attitudes. I think a lot of people, too, didn't take into consideration the fact that they were going to last. Everybody, including a lot of performers and television hosts, had said, you know, they weren't going to last, and that they were terrible singers. And
a lot of parents had hoped they would not last.
Yes, I guess so.
I remember my own parents talking about any time my hair would get in my eyes, they'd say, you got one of those Beatle haircuts. I mean, the haircut was named after them.
Yeah.
Was John leading the direction toward the more revolutionary? Because his hair seemed to get longer and the beard fuller.
Well, they did, but in England at the time, even when we went over there, the Rolling Stones, a group that America had yet to hear of, was longer, and they were scruffy, and because the Beatles started to get accepted by the establishment, all of a sudden a lot of the allegiance went to the Stones over there. But John Lennon, like tonight, I think that I would like to use this opportunity to extend on a lot of John's friends our condolences to Yoko Ono, who was his woman, who he stood by, and she stood by him, and she made a great contribution to him as a person, which was what he needed. I think that was his own, the reason for his self-exile. A lot of people thought that John Lennon, and perhaps rightfully so, that he was caustic and cynical, but of them all, he was the kindest man that I ever met in show business. He had a sensitivity. I got hung up about that term, the fifth Beatle was parasitical. I couldn't stand to interview them anymore, and he gave me a pep talk, and he was very, he had a lot of empathy. I was really trying to, also, it was him that introduced me to the Rolling Stones and asked me to bring them to the country for the first time.
Was John Lennon honest when you found him saying things, or was it for effect?
No, I think that the one thing I will always remember about John Lennon was he's the most honest man, most truthful man, a man with tremendous integrity. And if there was a song that I could pick, I think it isn't a John Lennon song, although it was from Sgt. Pepper. It was a George Harrison song which said, life goes on within you and without you.
Murray the K, thank you very much. Tom, back to you in New York.
Thank you, Murray the K, and Boyd Matson in Burbank this morning. It's 17 minutes now before 9 o'clock. This could be the year that you start buying batteries by the gross, it turns out. Nancy Foreman will tell you why after a station break.
That new show, number 96, doesn't start till December 10th.
I'll wait.
Chances are you are familiar with the buzz and the gurgles and the beeps of computer toys. And Christmas may bring a few more of those into your home. But now, those sounds may be coming from the crib, because new on the market from Tiger Toy is an electronics toy designed for babies. And here to tell us more about that is Susan Labor, Chief of Child Development in the Pediatrics Department at the University of Chicago Medical Center. Now then, Susan, isn't 6 months of age a little bit young for an electronic toy?
Not basically. I really feel very strongly that as our society becomes increasingly reliant on technology, that we'll have to introduce children to technology at ever increasingly earlier ages. The other aspect of this is that we've done some research at the University of Chicago that shows that infants are really able to profit from stimulation, especially in the area of visual and auditory discrimination, at very early ages, even as early as 3 to 6 months. So a toy that stimulates a child in the crib is really something that's very necessary for a young child.
So rattles may be passé before long.
No, well, not necessarily. I think rattles are very important too because they give the child a chance to really move his hands and his eyes together.
You know, in just 4 years, electronic toys have grown into an $800 million business. And I'm wondering what effect those toys have on kids in general.
Well, I think that it's really going to be something that's hard to measure. First, as you say, it's really an infant industry. And I think that some of the ways that we've learned to measure children by achievement scores and intelligence scores may not be the way that we will end up measuring the gains that are gotten from early childhood education programs or, for instance, from educational TV or from these electronic computerized toys that we're offering children at earlier ages. They give children just an amazing amount of information at very, very early ages.
I've watched some of the children play those and their hands just fly over the keyboard. Are they developing this kind of hand-eye coordination at an earlier age?
Very important, yes. I think that this is something that we've noticed, I've noticed especially in my observations, that children all of a sudden are able to use, well, we're finding that they're able to use, they've probably already been able to use it for many years, but we're able to see that they can use this at earlier and earlier ages. And I think that these computer toys that help children push buttons and get an immediate feedback, the intelligence factor that a computer toy provides, I think that's very important.
Don't we have to keep in mind that it's good for kids to get outdoors and actually play the football games, the baseball games, physically as well as on the little machines?
Oh, absolutely. I think that we have to keep in mind a good, healthy mixture of toys and games and activities for children. I think although computer toys are a terribly important thing to offer children for stimulation at early ages, that you need to have areas that'll stress muscle development, social development, so that children need to get outside and play, and will always need lots and lots of toys like puzzles and games.
Good advice, Susan, and thanks for being with us today.
Thank you.
We'll be back after these messages.
This year's isotoners are here. The high-performance gloves by Aris, with that famous isomassage action as standard equipment. They give you the Aris touch with sleek, racy lines, real leather strips, and custom colors. One size, so they're great gifts. Isotoner by Aris, the better idea in gloves. Find isotoner gloves by Aris at stores all across the country.
A wonderful surprise, Mama.
What's this?
There's something about a train
that's
magic.
The honeymoon you never had.
Traveling near or far. Seeing it all, having such fun.
To another 50 years.
Training the Amtrak way.
If you suffer from minor arthritis pain, listen to what these people say about Aspercream.
I really felt like I was rubbing the pain away.
The relief lasts for hours.
Aspercream contains salicin, a strong non-aspirin pain reliever which penetrates right to the point of arthritis pain.
Aspercream gives me relief without upsetting my stomach.
There's no odor.
I'm saying that I am really pleased with the relief I got from Aspercream.
Aspercream, strong, effective relief right where you hurt.
Swoosie Kurtz. That's known as saving time in an intro. Swoosie is now on Broadway in a play called The Fifth of July, a very good play indeed. She's a cuckoo person. This is not unusual in your acting career to be cuckoo persons, right?
Oh, I'm perfectly normal, really, Gene.
I must ask you, because everybody wants to know, we know so few people named Swoosie when it's not a nickname. How did you get the name?
Okay, here goes. I was named after a B-17 that my father flew in the war. And there was a song out.
There's your father's jacket. Your jacket. Right on screen.
Oh.
Go ahead.
You should hang me up there and talk to the jacket. No, seriously, though. It was a Kay Kaiser song called Half Swan, Half Goose, Alexander is a Swoose. And the plane was made up of old parts and new parts. So it was sort of a hybrid you see, kind of like me. So they called me Swoos after the plane.
You work a lot. There was one time that you wanted to have a helicopter fly you between two plays so that you could do two plays at the same time.
My agent and I have been known to check the helicopter schedules. I'm greedy that way. I want to do all the parts.
What drives you like that? I mean...
Oh, fear, I think.
Fear of unemployment?
Of depression, of having a moment where I don't have something to do. Also just total love of being someone else other than me.
Is it a way to escape reality?
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Do you become the person you are in the play? Now, in the 5th of July, which is now on Broadway, you are a screwball-type character. Some people think you are burnt out because earlier in the career of this character, you use drugs here and there.
Right. She's taken every drug known to man. She was in Berkeley's during the 60s. She's had everything removed by the time she was 25. And she says, I'm 33 and burned out. Well, she's not really, because she's very articulate. But... I think it's probably my favorite part so far.
That you ever played? Well, mm-hmm. Now, there's got to be a close second because you were with Nichols and May and Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf at Long Wharf in Connecticut. Now, that's got to be a big experience.
Polar opposite of the part I'm playing now. Honey in Virginia Woolf is so ingrown and repressed and petrified. You know, she says, excuse me, can you tell me where the... She can't even say bathroom, you know, so he says, tell her where the euphemism is, you know. She's so terrified of everything. So she drinks brandy and then it all comes out. But totally the opposite of the part I'm playing now. That was a marvelous experience.
You had heard of Mike Nichols and Elaine May. You hadn't worked with them before. Were you apprehensive before you met them?
Yes, I was terrified. I thought, I didn't buy a one of those month-long tickets on the New Haven Railroad because I thought... Maybe I will only be there for a couple of days. I thought I might just get fired. You never know when you work with tremendous superstars like that.
But it worked out.
Oh, God.
They're good people.
They couldn't have been more generous and loving and supportive and hilarious. And
now, what's it like on the 5th of July on Broadway? You've got Chris Reeve there, and you've got a very good cast. You've got a big cast. Is there camaraderie? Is there jealousy backstage?
Oh, the tension is so thick backstage.
You can hardly move,
cut
right?
Cut it with a knife.
Has it ever happened to you in a play?
None of us can stand each other. Hasn't, actually. I've been really fortunate. Actors are terrific people, you know.
She was only kidding, folks. Everybody likes each other backstage at the 5th of July.
Yeah.
And the people out front like it pretty well, too.
They love it. They love it.
Susie Kurtz, you're going to have a big career. You've got mating something, what?
Oh, well, the mating season.
The mating season, and that's with Lucy Arnaz.
Right.
And Larry Luckenbill, her husband.
Mm-hmm.
You've got television shows coming up. You've got a Broadway show.
Mm-hmm. A couple of films maybe in the works later this year.
And you've got a big future. And an unforgettable name. Who can forget Swoosie? Half swan, half goose.
Thank you.
Swoosie Kurtz. Good luck. We'll be back, this old plain Gene, after these messages.
1904, the Prim twins fly 2 seconds nonstop. Ovaltine is there. 1925, Barry O'Brien does a perfect figure six. Ovaltine is there. 1958, Peggy Potter hooters her hoop 80 times. Ovaltine is there. For 75 years, Ovaltine milk flavoring has given kids vitamins and minerals they need and the good, rich, chocolatey taste they love. Ovaltine milk flavoring, because parents know what's good for kids, and kids know what's good.
How are you today?
Worried. I've got a Christmas gift problem.
Gifts are easy at Hickory Farms. Relax. Try our beef stick.
Mm, very nice.
We've got gift packs with beef stick and cheese, too, like Smoky Bar. You tell us your gift problems, Hickory Farms will solve them.
Oh, well, I have quite a few.
We'll even send your gifts.
No, thanks. I'll deliver them myself.
Christmas gifts that are sure to please the Super Cheese Pocket.
Your Bell Phone Center has a great new way to say hello, with Big Hello gift certificates. They're good for giving a stylish decorator phone, or for helping someone you love to reach out and touch someone, or for giving special features, like our call waiting to someone who gets a lot of calls.
Hold on, I have another call.
All right.
Hello?
So, if you're stumped for an original gift idea, give Big Hello gift certificates from your Bell Phone Center store, and ask us about charging them to your bill.
It's been a morning of sadness. We have been dealing with the news of the death of John Lennon, murdered last night on Manhattan's West Side. But it has also been a morning of special memories, I think, for a lot of people, not just in this country, but around the world. So many lives were touched by John Lennon and his life and his music, and people are remembering that today. We have been here on the Today program as well. We want to pay a final farewell now to him with one of his loveliest and most poignant songs, Imagine.
Tuesday, there are 300 laughs in the Steve Allen Comedy Hour. Here's one.
The weather's going to be sunny, followed by Cher.
With guest star Martin Mull Tuesday.
Will Anthea convince Nathan to leave? Can Horace get Lisa to stay?